Good afternoon, Forever Young. I'm your hostess today. You probably remember me from before. My name is Barbara Alexandro, and I've got a special lady that I've known for quite a while with me today, and her name is Jane Oliver. She's from CareNet, and her title is Community and Event Specialist, a long title. So, but what we're going to say, Jane, is I know CareNet is fairly comprehensive in this area, but can you tell me, our listeners, exactly what CareNet does?
So CareNet comes alongside men and women who are facing unplanned pregnancies. We provide free services. All of our services are free and confidential. We provide free pregnancy testing, free pregnancy confirmation, free ultrasounds. We try to help them walk through, we do pregnancy decision counseling and help them explore all of their options when facing an unplanned pregnancy. We provide medically accurate abortion information and things like that.
Well, you know, I'm so impressed because I think your viewpoint or the way that you approach pregnancy with an unwed mother is very special in the fact that you use ultrasounds with them. How does that seem to change their reality?
Yes, a lot of our clients who receive an ultrasound will oftentimes say, it's a baby. It just gives them that window to the womb to see what's actually going on inside their bodies instead of believing some of the contradictory information and lies that the world would have them believe that it's not a baby or, you know, a life to be valued. So it gives them that window to the womb, and as a result, over 80% of our women choose life who have an ultrasound.
And you know, choosing life, I just read a statistic. We're in, of course, the COVID year. This is 2021. And I read a statistic that sort of shocked me because we're so concerned about deaths and how that COVID impacts the death rate. I read where 900,000 babies were aborted during the time that COVID has been in existence. That was very shocking to me. And do you have any other statistics, like for Port St. Lucie area or the Florida area, you could give us?
Here on the Treasure Coast, we're still working on our 2020 statistics, mm-hmm. And they are higher because when faced with the pandemic, our unplanned pregnancies were facing fear on top of fear, as you can imagine. Mm-hmm. So we did see an increase in clients during that time. Fortunately, we were able to stay open. So I don't have those, but our 2019 statistics I can share. We provided over 5,000 free services. So it saves the medical community and just our community as a whole a lot of money in that. We had 1,441 client visits, 257 men's sessions, 101 accepted Christ, because at the heart of what we do is the gospel. And so our goal is to not only enable them to choose life, but to choose abundant life through a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. 128 babies were saved from abortion, and 202 ultrasounds were performed. Total of 529 attended parenting classes or our IRMA You Learn Mommy Mentor sessions. So.
And that's really great. And I know that you have, those are sometimes one-on-one, aren't they?
Yes.
With the counselors and things.
Right.
So why we're talking to you as the age group that you are, because you're the forever young, 50 and above, so why we're talking to you about a pregnancy center is that we want you to understand that this is a volunteer organization and most of the things that happen are done through volunteers. Could you tell me, Jane, exactly some of the jobs or, slots that they could fill?
Sure.
Being a forever young person?
Sure. Another part of what we do, I want to just take a moment to mention too, is our abortion recovery program. So we minister to men and women who are suffering from the trauma of abortion. And for many people, it ends up being many years later. And so that's one way that we can use volunteers if that's something they have in their past. We help them find healing and wholeness first, and then they are There's no one better to minister to our men and women who are either facing that unplanned pregnancy decision or who have past abortion trauma. They're very, very useful. The Lord uses their story to help others and redeems all that. It's amazing. But some other ways are we need peer counselors that we train. We provide 2 full weekends of training. And they minister to our couples that come in. We are in desperate need of men because we know that there's a dad involved, and he's a huge part of a woman's choice as to whether she'll choose life or not based on him. So we're in desperate need of men, male volunteers who will come alongside our men and mentor them and help them walk through that decision as well. And receptionist. We use volunteer receptionists. As you mentioned, Barbara, we have a very small staff, and we could not do what we do without our volunteers. They are the heartbeat of our ministry. And so receptionist is an option. We have a helpline that is available when our phones are down on the weekends, and so people are needed to answer phones. What else? We have volunteer nurses, volunteer sonographers, so we're always in need of that. The possibilities really are endless. Mommy mentors, as we mentioned, there are people that sit one-on-one with our moms and dads and go through parenting videos and things like that. We bring in guest speakers to our parenting classes. We'll have people come in and talk about whatever it is, finances, housekeeping, childbirth, CPR. There's so many different subjects that we're able to pull people into that can share their life experience and their specialties with our parents.
How many centers do you actually have in the Treasure Coast?
So here on the Treasure Coast, we have 3 centers. We just opened our third one.
Oh, great.
Our original one started 32 years ago in Port St. Lucie. We're located off of US 1 in northern Port St. Lucie, and then we have our second center is located in Stewart on US 1 as well. And we just opened our third center in Darwin Square in western Port St. Lucie. So
that's going to pick up a lot of new blood, because that's one of our most growing communities is the tradition area. It's called western Port St. Lucie, but most of us who are living here know it as just plain tradition. And Darwin, that's pretty close, isn't it?
It is close. It's a different zip code. Darwin Square is 34953.
Uh-huh.
And so we had always thought in expanding that our next logical step would be a center in Fort Pierce. Then we would have Stewart, Port St. Lucie, and Fort Pierce. But we evaluated the statistics and the number of impressions on our website. The majority of them were coming from the 34953 zip code area.
Interesting.
And so we saw a real need there, and that's where our executive director and board began to look and found a space. And we've already seen 18 clients and had a full ultrasound schedule.
Wonderful.
So we're filling, meeting that need out there. So it's exciting.
Well, that is exciting. And then I just wanted to ask you, I know you said there were over 5,000 tests, medical tests run, and where does that money come from? Because I know you can't do things without some sort of resources.
Right. We are a nonprofit, so our funding comes from local churches and private donors. We get a small amount of money from our Choose Life license plate. That money is earmarked for clients who want to choose adoption. But yeah, we're supported by people in the community and our local churches. So,
and I'm just affiliated with CareNet because I've always gone to their banquets. And could you just give us a little snapshot of what that banquet is like?
Sure. We do have 2 major fundraisers that we do a year. One of those is our fall banquet, and the other one is our Walk for Life. And so the fall banquet is held on 2 nights. And it's a free event. We a lot of people will step up to be table hosts and invite guests to join us. And so there's no monetary expectation to attend the banquet, but of course it is a fundraiser, so there is an opportunity to give. At that banquet, we give an overview of the ministry and what we've done in the past year. We have our client and Baby of the Year share their testimony. And so it's a very moving evening, and that's our biggest, single largest fundraiser of the year. And then in the spring, we do our Walk for Life. So.
And I know even Jane was telling us that even during the COVID, they were really sort of concerned because their event, I'm talking about their you know, the big dinner that they put on, and it is all complimentary to anyone who attends, but they were sort of a little bit leery about doing it through a COVID environment. But God gave you the strength, and you all just forged ahead and did it. And how many people did you have?
So we had, the two nights combined, we had 650 people, which is only 250 less than the year before, which was our largest ever crowd. So it was a pretty amazing evening.
So these are mostly Christians, I'd say, for the most part, or if not, they're people who understand what CareNet is about and have a heart and a passion for that. But we're just glad that of all the things, because so many things were canceled, and we're just glad that you didn't cancel that.
Yes, we were grateful. Know. And yeah. I think that's, a lot of people were just ready to get out of the house.
I know.
It was a good cause, which was the other huge pull. But yes, that was it was a blessing to be able to do that, and the people who came, just, it was like a big party. People were just kind of ready to.
Yeah, we were ready to.
We were social distanced and wearing masks, but it was it was a lot of fun. And coincidentally, we also raised the most ever raised at a banquet, with the exception of 1 year, which was back when we had the back-to-back hurricanes way back,
and
because a lot of people were blessed by a lot of extra insurance money that year, but this was the highest. 2020 was the highest amount raised.
Yeah. Well, let's take a look at your. How do you decide about the mother of the year or the baby of the year? I know you pick one each year to be promoted, and you use them for some of your advertising and videos. How do you pick that person?
It is a difficult decision. Our client services director, Ray Mazugal, in our Port St. Lucie Center, kind of heads that up. And now that we have three centers, you know, they'll probably put their heads together, each center director, to kind of see whose story sticks out. Or like this year, our theme is Survive and Thrive. And so by the time it comes, we pick that baby of the year right before our banquet, and, you know, do the video and all of their story. And so we'll have to see what our theme is going to be for the fall banquet. And they'll just kind of, like I said, go through and see whose story sticks out. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, it's a very courageous and brave thing for these moms to step up and be willing to share their story with the general public and, you know, people they don't know. So we recognize that. So it takes a special person. So months of prayer really go into it. We pray as a staff that the Lord will provide, you know, just the right client and baby of the year. And he knows, and he is faithful to do that every year. And it's amazing how their story always ties incredibly in with what our theme that God has given us. So we look forward every year to who that's going to be.
What was the name of the lady that came this year as your, you know, your mother of the year?
The client of the year this year, her name is Rinaldia, and her little baby of the year is Nyana.
Nyana.
There you were. In the shadows, holding out your hand, you met me there. And now, where would I be without you? Where would I be, Jesus? You were the voice in the desert, calling me out.
Well, before I got pregnant, most of the time I would find myself working, spending time with family. I was 23, so I was traveling a lot with most of my friends from school. Just being a lot more involved in the community. So, like I said, working, friends, family, that's mainly what I was doing. I actually found out I was pregnant when I was 4 months into my pregnancy. I had no symptoms. No idea that I was pregnant. And when I started to see that my belly was getting a little bigger, I ended up taking a couple of at-home pregnancy tests, and they all came back positive, and I didn't want to believe it. So it was crazy because I Googled like pregnancy tests in the area. And the first place it sent me to was a place in Jensen, and it was completely, it looked like a flower shop, and I was like, no, this can't be it. Then I looked right underneath and it was CareNet. And I called and I spoke to the receptionist and she said, yeah, we actually had an appointment, but she canceled, so you can come right in. And I sat with one of the counselors and that was a very emotional day for me because I finally knew that I was pregnant.
You never gave up on me. You were my testimony.
I come from a Christian family. So finding out that I was pregnant, not married, it was hard. I didn't want to believe it. I think that's why I really waited so long, because I was like, no, this can't be happening. I just graduated from nursing school. I was, like I said, living my life and out of nowhere, having a baby. These are things you plan for. So when I found out that I was actually pregnant and I couldn't do anything about it, it really hurt me at first. I talked with the counselor and she came and told me that I was pregnant. And I told her I don't want to keep the baby. But then again, I knew I wanted a baby, but just not in this circumstance. And she prayed with me and she counseled me and I prayed about it. And I said, I'm gonna keep the baby regardless what my family says. So thinking about how I could keep this baby, if it was a good decision to keep it or not, it was going back and forth. On one hand, I have my life. I wanted to do travel nursing. I wanted to see the world. And then on the other hand, I'm like, God gave me this baby for a reason. It doesn't matter what my timing was. It was his timing. So it really was pulling against my flesh and my religious side, because it's like, you don't want to, nobody wants to have an abortion. Nobody just goes into this saying, hey, oh, I'm going to get pregnant and then just throw the baby away. But then again, it's like, I'm only 23. I literally been in school right after high school. So it's just like not being able to experience all that I wanted before I settled down to have a baby was really frustrating. But at the end, I kept her. When I first saw that ultrasound, I think everything came into play, you know. At first, it was just a heartbeat at first, you know. I mean, you see your belly growing, but you don't really think about it. But when you actually see the baby's fingers and her nose, and it's a person now, it's not just a thing, it's actually, you put a name to that baby and you see it, and that right there, I mean, nobody can change that feeling. I mean, you can be up against the world, and just seeing that baby's picture just changes everything. CareNet helped me make the decision to carry Nayana because they were there for me. Yeah, I mean, even though I had a good job, but I didn't really have a good support system. So just being able to come to a place, speaking with somebody, them not judging you. Yes, they have faith, but at the same time, they embrace and they understand that things happen. I mean, that right there, nobody can repay CareNet for. Now that power lives in me, there is another in the fire. I mean, I thank God for CareNet. I mean, I found CareNet on the internet. And look at what it done for me. I mean, I didn't even know anything about babies. I didn't know how to make a bottle. When I say I had no idea about babies, like the parenting classes, I mean, they helped so much. I mean, it's crazy. Like, yeah, I'm a nurse, but we don't deal with babies every day. So just to be able to go to a place and learn little things like knowing what kind of cries, what the cry means to the baby, being able to learn about their symptoms, knowing how pregnancy is in general, how your emotions are up and down. That's really how CARE DAT helped me through this pregnancy, mainly just being a support system for me when I really had nobody. So I normally used to come every Fridays in the morning and just learn, basically. And these are things that you might say, oh, a 30-minute video is nothing, but when you have a baby and she's sitting there in front of you crying and you don't know what cry means what, those 30-minute videos really help. It made me feel truly blessed coming to CARENET, being able to find not just resources, but support. It wasn't just the facility that helps, but they also help build your faith. I mean, with the, I would read verses with my mentor. She would really help me get through these tough times, because it's like growing up in, like I said, in a religion, you know what to do, but doing it is a different thing. So having somebody to help you, support you through that time in need, it's unimaginable. My family, especially my dad, he was like, I mean, if that was his baby, he would sign the birth certificate himself. He loves Nayana to pieces. My dad has, this baby has really brought joy and brought our family closer. I thought it was gonna tear us apart, but I mean, that Nayana has brought us all closer together. I mean, before, because my dad doesn't stay here, he stays in Broward. So, I mean, I would see him most of the time once a month, twice a month. But now he's up every week. Every week, 3 days a week, and he watches her while I go to work with me now. So, I mean, like I said, before, me and my dad's relationship wasn't really, you know, good because of the before this, but mainly because of the pregnancy. It was kind of rough because nobody wants to see their first daughter not married and then go have a baby and just be on it on her own, but Nayana was worth it. He loves her to pieces. He FaceTimes her every day. So now that I have a precious little me, Nayana, life has very much been different. At first, it was very tough. Like I said, through my pregnancy, very much complications. I was in labor for like 3 days. They ended up doing a C-section. So trying to recover, having a crying baby at your side, it was very tough. And I thought, at first, I thought she might hate me. She doesn't know what I went through to have her, and she might not necessarily, you know, understand all that I did, but, and she would always cry. But now she sees me. I'm able to, you know, have that skin-to-skin bond with her. It's so rewarding. I mean, just to see her every day and giving me encouragement to be like, yeah, life is tough, but I'm worth it, you know. Yes, they have faith, but at the same time, they embrace and they understand that things happen. I mean, that right there, nobody can remain CARENET for.
Well, we heard them speak today at our event, and she said it was strange because I think she said that she was 4 months pregnant.
Yes.
Before she even contacted any place. And I think when she called, there might have been something that she thought she got a Planned Parenthood. Is that right?
Well,
something?
She had looked up on her phone, on the internet, pregnancy tests in Port St. Lucie, I believe is what she Googled. And so her GPS directed her to a plaza, which is actually in Stewart, because when she pulled up, she said, this is a flower shop.
So yeah, she knew, that's what she said.
She knew they weren't giving pregnancy tests at the flower shop, but what had previously been in that plaza that was closed at the time was a Planned Parenthood. And so when she looked at her phone again, knowing that wasn't the right information, she saw CARENET right below that first, you know, entry that she had followed, and called us. And as God would have it, there was a client who canceled their appointment right before she called, and we were able to see her right then at that moment, which God
which
knew,
is very
I'm sure
timely,
was pivotal.
Right? Yes, because mm-hmm. I know these babies that come into these homes, though, they are so blessed, and they do. She was saying that her family, she thought maybe this, because she was a mother without a husband and a single mother, and she thought it would probably divide or separate her family from her, But just the opposite happened, right? What the little girl, she was so sweet. That her father takes care, the grandfather takes care of the baby because she's an RN and she just finished her training. So, I mean, you can see where support is very vital for these women to continue in their daily living as far as jobs and their education or whatever. But, you know, it is very important for that support from that family, that nuclear family. And I know, I just want to tell a story, and I'm just take the limelight away from you, but I was a teacher for a long time, and one of our girls in our program was got pregnant, and of course we tried to explain, the staff was trying to, we were counseling her and trying to explain about abortions and, you know, CareNet, because that was down in Lake Worth. And she really chose to abort her baby. And I will tell you that that girl was the head cheerleader. She was a straight A student. And after she aborted that baby, she went, she just pivoted down to, she didn't get good grades. She dropped out of cheerleading. It was a sad, very sad story. But we saw firsthand, because we knew this girl for 4 years, she was one of our students, we saw firsthand what happens to these girls when they do abort. There's such a, it's a post-abortion crisis is a lot,
right?
You know.
And that's one of the things we seek to do, if they'll allow us to, is share the truth about abortion, the medical truth, which includes the fact that there are not only physical risks, but emotional risks with abortion. And the majority of women, you know, will come back and say that, you know, they had not planned on the emotional risks. And some of them, it may take many, many years, but we find a lot of those women, you know, and seek to walk them through the healing and freedom they can find in Christ. You know,
even that's another program that's just so valuable, because I know at church we see women later, much later, even after they've had children and they're gone, then they seem to revisit this. And your center helps with that post-abortion crisis.
You know, for men and women. There are men also who are suffering from abortion, you know, in their teenage years, and they might be in their 60s now. And you know, so they're left with that, or their complicitness maybe in the abortion back then. So we see men and women both who suffer from that, and are, it's amazing to get to walk them through that process.
The
Our counselors
healing, right?
are incredible.
Yeah. And now when you, when these women come to you, how many of them would you say have the support of the man who is the father who was in that relationship? Do you see more of them or less of the fathers?
I would say a good majority of them. Well, they might not be in a, they're not all necessarily in a committed or a marriage relationship, but I would say a good majority of them have a partner. And because we have a men's director, when that partner comes with them, we're able to kind of scoop him up and take him aside and help him walk through the critical thinking and, you know, what is it you want, and the importance of him supporting her. Not just saying I support your decision, whatever that may be, but if he's wanting her to choose life, how important it is to say that out loud. You know, I will support you. We can do this together. You know, it's not going to be easy, but we can do this. And so we hope to just kind of walk them through that critical thinking, to think beyond the moment of that decision staring them in the face. You know, think about it down the road. What will life look like if abortion's part of your story, as opposed to what will life look like if you chose life? And, you know, we don't promise that road to be easy for anyone. But as you said, Barbara, we're there for support so that we can just give them a good support system. And, you know, we help with physical needs as well. We have community resources that we can refer them to. We have a baby boutique, so we carry maternity.
Oh, I know, that boutique is so cute. And people, you know, another thing that the Forever Young crowd could do is we just gave Jane a whole big like almost a shopping bag full of little hats, and tell them what you do with those little hats, because that was very special.
A lot of, we love to get the handmade items, they're really special. And so we have people that make us little hats, or might make us afghans or blankets, and we keep those in the ultrasound room. So when the moms and dads have their ultrasound, we can hand that right to them, and it just kind of makes it a personal gift. Some of them even, you know, get emotional when they're handed that that gift. And you know, right now, just kind of circling back to ultrasounds, because of COVID, we have encountered a lot of clients, or even I've just encountered people out in the community that I know are pregnant who have shared the fact that their partner is not permitted to come with them for the ultrasound. And so men already don't have that physical attachment, and so that's one way to draw them in with the ultrasound. And so that's why it's even more important that we do offer the free ultrasound, and we do include the men or support person, partner, whoever might come with the woman.
And that's so important. And I just want to get away from your care net, but what's happening in America as far as the Planned Parenthood centers and the For Life centers? Are we winning this war, would you say?
Statistically, yes. In fact, Sue Chess, our executive director, just shared with me yesterday that the newest polls, 47% of Americans are pro-life.
Wow, that's wonderful.
44 were pro-choice, and I'm not sure what the other... small percentage was left. Is I guess they're undecided, likely.
So we are
winning the war,
right?
And the best way, you know, that we can win the war is to create awareness and get behind our pregnancy resource centers. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of people think, well, there's nothing I can do, and abortion is never going to become illegal, and you know, it's hopeless, and it's certainly not hopeless. You know, God is on the throne, and He goes before us, and the way that He blesses this ministry, the way that He brings the clients who find us to us, and just divine appointments is incredible. And so, you know, what we need our community and our churches to do is to really rally behind our pregnancy resource centers to make sure that the people in our community know that we exist, and also the people in our churches. You know, oftentimes we will hear from clients who are attending church. Statistically, the majority of our clients have been in church within the past month.
Isn't that interesting?
And so the church has a real call to minister to these women and men and make sure that they know where to go, where their first resource should be, at a pregnancy resource center, where they're going to be met with hope and compassion and the truth.
Well, the truth is very important, because as God would have it, the Holy Spirit always leads us to the truth. And that's very important, that these people, these young people, and they're most usually young, are led to the truth of what they're really dealing with, because they're really dealing with a baby formed by God. I think it's just a miracle when you look at it. And I just wanted to tell a little story. I adopted my son Matthew, and I know his mom, his birth mom, and she and I are really good friends, and every time I see her, I always thank her for not aborting my Matthew, because it's real with me. So that's sort of how I got involved with CareNet many, many years ago, because my son is in his 40s, late 40s now, so you know, it never leaves you. It's part of your life, your nuclear story, and it's part of life, and it's a wonderful concept. And I just want to thank you, Jane, for coming and sharing your story with us today. And I want to thank our viewers for tuning in to Forever Young, and we appreciate you, and God bless you.
Thank you for having me, Barbara.